I don't know if you have met my wife, but before I start, I would like to introduce my wife, Norma, at the back of the room. I said in the introduction or the dedication of my first book that she makes everything possible. And she still makes everything possible. I don't know, some of you probably have read my first book, The Coming of the Train, which is the first volume of a history that I'm doing on the Hoosac Tunnel and Wilmington Railroad and the industries that it served in the upper Deerfield River Valley. When I started, I thought if I could get 100 pages of interest about a little railroad like that, it would be a miracle. The first book was 384 pages, and I only got to 1910. So the second volume, which I thought would take me the rest of the way, I've been working on it now for 2 years, and I hope it will be done in February. It'll get me to 1922. So I hope I live long enough to finish this thing. Tonight I'm going to talk about a subject that's in the second book. It's how the railroads, the Hoosac Tunnel and Wilmington Railroad in particular, but also some other railroads, affected the development of the Deerfield River hydroelectric development. Before I start that, let's just look back at the beginning of the development of the upper Deerfield. Before 1880, it was a very rural and isolated area, but starting in 1880, the Newton brothers from Greenfield and from Holyoke, the Newton family owned a sawmill here in Greenfield. James Newton Sr. Had a sawmill where the Rugg Lumber Company is, and the Newton family farm was where the Newton School is. The Newton brothers, four of them, were instrumental in developing the paper industry in Holyoke. But by 1880, they realized that the resources that were available to them along the Connecticut River were running out, and they needed to develop some new resources for their paper industry, primarily wood pulp and timber. So they went to the upper Deerfield River, Reedsboro, and they built a pulp mill, and adjacent to the pulp mill, they built a box factory, and then they became involved in furniture manufacturing, so they turned Reedsboro, which was a sleepy little town of about 400 people, into a thriving community of around 1,200 people by 1900. To get their products out of the valley, they built the Hoosac Tunnel and Wilmington Railroad to bring their wood pulp and their other products from Reedsboro and further up the valley down to the connection with the Fitchburg Railroad, which eventually became the Boston and Maine Railroad, at Hoosac Tunnel. One of the Newton associates, James Ramage, built the Ramage Paper Company in Monroe Bridge, and the paper company that started off as the Ramage Company, you probably would know as Deerfield Glassine. Eventually, they extended the railroad up along the Deerfield through Whitingham and on to Wilmington, which became its terminus in 1891. And about 2 miles west of Wilmington, the Newtons built a complex called Mountain Mills. There was a very large pulp manufacturing plant there, large lumber mills, and they supplied that Mountain Mills complex with logs that were floated down the Deerfield River from Searsburg, Somerset, and Glastonbury. But by 1907, the Newtons had sold their interest in the upper Deerfield Valley. They had sold the railroad in 1904 to John Kellis, and they sold their mountain mills and lumber assets to the Deerfield Lumber Company in 1906. So they were pretty much out of the picture in the upper valley by 1907, and a new era of entrepreneurs was starting to take over. The United States was becoming aware of the wonders of electricity starting in the late 1800s. The Chicago World's Fair of 1893 made the ordinary American aware of the potential of electric lights and the effect that electricity could have on their lives. And by 1900, many homes had lights, stores had lights. Power was being generated generally locally by small generating plants within a village. It was direct current power. And if you lived more than 5 miles from the power plant, you couldn't get electricity because direct current power could not be transmitted over any kind of a distance. By 1900, a company called Westinghouse had developed an alternating current motor that was very attractive to manufacturers for powering machinery. But here again, they needed the alternating current power to run it, and that was not generally available. In 1902, a group of businessmen in Brattleboro received a charter from the state of Vermont and the state of New Hampshire to build a dam and a power plant on the Connecticut River in Brattleboro, and they were going to use the power to supply local industry. However, they found that even though they had the charter, they couldn't get the financing to build the plant because it was unproven technology. And just like today, banks weren't willing to advance capital to build projects that were unproven. Coincidental with the group in Brattleboro, Malcolm Chase and Henry Harriman, two young men in the textile business, formed a partnership in 1903 called Chase and Harriman, and they had a new idea for the development of the electric industry. And their idea was that they would locate a power plant in a remote area at the source of water. They were going to build hydroelectric power plants, so they decided they would find a location where there was a plentiful supply of water and generate the electricity at that location and then transmit it over transmission lines to cities and factories a distance away. This was something that was completely unproven. There had been a little bit of work done in that area at Niagara Falls, but there was still many, many unknowns. The first unknown was, could you find a river or a source of water power that was consistent? How far could you transmit the power? Could you obtain the rights of way for the transmission lines? Eminent domain was not available at that time. And would local manufacturers be willing to make the investment to convert their factories over to electric powered machinery? Well, in 1906, Chase and Harriman linked up with the people with the charter in Brattleboro, and Chase and Harriman were willing to supply the money to develop the Brattleboro Dam and power plant. However, the first thing they found was that the area where the charter covered, there was 200 feet of sand below the riverbed, and it was impossible to build a dam there. They couldn't get down to the bedrock. So rather than give up, they looked up and down the river and they found a suitable location in Vernon. And they had the charters from Vermont and New Hampshire amended, And in 1907, they began construction of the Vernon hydroelectric power plant. Here we see the dam under construction in August of 1907. And here's the power plant itself, partially completed in 1908. Vernon went online in June of 1909, and very quickly the idea of Chase and Harriman was proven to be feasible. They could transmit electricity over quite a long distance, and the power from Vernon immediately went to the Worcester area in Fitchburg, and very quickly they realized that they could not generate enough power in Vernon to satisfy the demand that was growing exponentially. So they began looking for another area to develop. Harriman particularly was the idea man, and he traipsed all over New England looking for suitable locations. Chase was a money man. He was from a wealthy family. He knew wealthy families, so he was real good at raising the money. And Harriman was out tramping through the woods trying to find places to build power plants. Well, he and his engineer Jed Beal decided that the ideal spot to develop was the Deerfield River. The source of the Deerfield is in Stratton, and it's not a there's not a lake or anything that's the source. It's just a lot of streams that come together out of the mountains of Stratton and Somerset, and gradually as the river travels through Somerset and then down along through Searsburg and Reedsboro, tributaries build up the supply of water. The Deerfield had some real advantages. It drops 1,800 feet in 50 miles, which is important for hydroelectric power generation. There was not a lot of development along the river. It was mostly forest and small farms. The watershed received some of the highest precipitation in Vermont, over 50 inches a year, and a lot of that in snow, of course. And maybe most important, the river, although a lot of it was in a wilderness area, it was accessible by a railroad. The Hoosac Tunnel and Wilmington Railroad ran from Hoosac Tunnel up to as far as Wilmington along the river, and then from Wilmington north through Searsburg, Somerset, and Stratton, the Deerfield River Railroad had been built, and that linked up with the Hoosac Tunnel and Wilmington and Mountain Mills. The Deerfield had one big disadvantage, and that was that it was either feast or famine. In the springtime, tremendous amounts of water. By August, it looked like this. And you can't generate electricity from a river when it looks like that. So what did they decide to do? They came up with the idea of treating the river as a unit, starting in Somerset and going all the way to Shelburne Falls. Instead of just putting up power plants, they realized that they had to develop the river as a whole. And one of the key steps of that was to build a storage reservoir in Somerset. So they were going to control the flow. They were going to acquire the rights of way and for the water rights and the land rights so they could build their dams. And they were going to choose their generating locations. And of course, they had to find the rights of way for their transmission lines. And they were able to do all of that, and they came out with a plan in 1911 to build generating plants in Shelburne Falls, plants 2, 3, and 4 in Conway and Shelburne Falls, a plant in Hoosac Tunnel, or just north of Hoosac Tunnel, which was known as number 5. It started off as a frequency converter plant, and I'll explain that in a minute, not a full hydroelectric power plant. it became a full hydroelectric plant in a couple of years. But the most important step was a reservoir at Somerset to store the water so that could release it over a period of time during the dry months of the year and continue to be able to generate power in Shelburne Falls. The plant at Hoosac Tunnel, number 5, I said it was a frequency converter plant. It was built to supply the Hoosac Tunnel with electricity for electric engines that the railroad started to run around 1911. The tunnel was so, the ventilation in the tunnel was so poor that steam engines running through there almost asphyxiated the passengers and the engineer. So they finally decided to electrify the tunnel, and as part of that electrification, number 5 power station of the power company was built to supply direct current for the electric engines. The first stage of that was the actual power was supplied from Vernon through Shelburne Falls to number 5, and it was converted for use by the railroad. 2 years later, the power company made number 5 into a full-fledged generating plant. So here we can see number 5 just north of the Hoosac Tunnel and stations 2, 3, and 4 in Shelburne Falls. The Somerset Reservoir was in a very remote location, but as I said, there was a railroad that went there. The Deerfield River Railroad started in Mountain Mills and wound its way up through Searsburg into Somerset, all the way up into Stratton, and there was a branch that went over to a location called Peck's Mill, and that's where the dam was going to be built. This railroad had been built to take the logs from the forest down to the lumber mill at Mountain Mills. But the power company used the railroad to bring the supplies that they were going to need to build the dam. Before they built the dam, they had to build the infrastructure to support it. And they built what was called a major development in that area. They had learned from the development of the Panama Canal, which was still ongoing in 1911, if you were going to avoid disease and a lot of problems with poor health of your employees, you better have good sanitation. And they built a camp at Somerset. Actually, they built 2 camps. And they had water supply. They had running water in all of the housing for the workers. They put in a sewage system so that there was complete sanitation facilities. They built the camp in 2 parts. One was called American Camp, and that was for the skilled workers, the foremen, the supervisors. And they had what they called the Italian Camp. That sounds kind of derogatory to us today, but at those times, it was not considered to be derogatory. The Italian camp was for the unskilled workers. The facilities might not have been quite as fancy as at the American camp, but it was still, they had running water, they had indoor plumbing, they had quite a few comforts. Let's take a look at American Camp, because it's interesting to look at life at that time. Here we've got a layout of the camp itself, and you can see that there was a main road. It didn't look like much, but it was a road going in 2 directions. Along the road, we had bunkhouses for unmarried workers. We had a mess hall. We had a hospital, We had individual cabins for foremen and families. We had foreman cabins now scattered through the woods. This is the Deerfield River Railroad that ran right through the camp on the way to the location of the dam. And looking at an overview as the camp was first being built, here we see what it looked like picture-wise. Here's the railroad. You can see a Deerfield River engine on here. Here's the ice house being built. These are bunk houses, mess hall. Looking at some of the individual buildings, the ice house. They had 1,000 tons of ice that they kept in this, and they cut the ice off of the Chase Pond, which was adjacent to the dam site. There was a workshop area adjacent to the camp. Here we see looking into the camp along the Deerfield River Railroad spur. We see a group of workers having lunch. Here we see the foreman's cabins scattered throughout the woods. And here's one of the foremen and his wife with a couple of friends stopping by. So you can see life wasn't too bad, even though it was cold in the winter. And the office building. Here, these people, as far as I've been able to identify, this is a Mr. Kernan and his wife. He was the timekeeper on the job, and he and his wife were there for the life of the job, which was about 3 years, a long time to spend in Somerset. And this gentleman here is a visitor from the Shelburne Falls office. This guy got there in the company car. This was quite a nice car for 1912, and you can see that Mrs. Kernan is enjoying sitting in the car, and the visitor seems to be enjoying sitting with Mrs. Kernan. I don't know where maybe Mr. Kernan took the picture, I don't know. There was a mess hall. With all of the comforts, we had a dinner bell and electric light over the door, and even a welcome mat so you didn't get mud in the hall. This was called Cottage Row. There was you can see rows of cottages along here for the employees, and we're going to be looking up Cottage Row in the direction of that arrow. And here we see a couple of residents of the cottages. We'll take a closer look at them. Pretty cute little hat, all dressed up for Sunday, it looks like. There was a hospital and a full-time doctor named Dr. Patch. And I guess he patched up workers if they got injured. You can see the original hospital was built in June 1912, and a year later, unfortunately, it burned to the ground. But it was rebuilt immediately in a slightly smaller version. They found, I guess, they didn't need it quite as large a hospital as they had originally thought. Looking back at our overall view, the Italian camp was adjacent to the American camp. And here we see a family out for a group photograph. And I love this guy's dog. He's proud, isn't he? Here's an overview of the campsite and the dam taken about beginning of 1913. This is the dam itself under construction. That area right in there is where the American camp was. This was the Italian camp. Here we have the engineering offices sitting on this knoll right here. The hospital was right about in this area here. There were maintenance buildings just down in that area right there where they serviced the locomotives and the various equipment. The fill for the, this was a dirt or earth fill dam, and the earth came from what was called a borrow pit, and that's the west borrow pit that we can see over along that ridge line, and I'll show you some close-ups on that in a minute. Here we have the intake when the dam is finished. That's where the water is going to go. And taking a look at a plan view, this is the east end of the dam, and you can see that it takes about a 6-degree bend right here. At the left end is a spillway, which would only be used if there was extreme high water and it was an emergency, the water would spill out here. The intake tower that we saw a minute ago is there, and the ordinary way for the power company to take the water from the reservoir is through that intake tower down through this conduit and out this gatehouse into the east branch of the river. And here you can see the slope of the dam with the conduit, the intake tower, the conduit, and the outlet here. The first step after the infrastructure was built was to open up the borrow pit. We use the term borrow pit. I don't know quite why, because they had no intention of returning the dirt after they used it. But it was, the borrow pit was located about a half a mile from the dam site. And all of the earth was moved with locomotives and dump cars, as we see here. They had to lay track from the dam site over through the woods to the location where the borrow pit would begin. They used on the dam site itself for rather than compressed air as we would think of today for drilling holes, they used a steam boiler and steam drills, steam powered drills. Here we see a close up of these steam drills. They look like compressed air drills, but they're powered by steam. And what these guys are doing here is they're drilling hole, which will be blasted out in this ledge for the conduit where the water will pass through the dam. It was also very important that they get all of the organic matter off of the site and they get everything down to bedrock. And that was done mostly by hand digging. They just scraped it off and loaded the dirt into carts and took it and dumped it. We see we have quite a diverse crew here. Spoke earlier of the borrow pit. Here we get a panoramic view of the pit, and you can see how large an enterprise this was. There were two steam shovels working in the pit all the time. In this particular view, we can see one steam shovel is actually loading trains, and when this picture was taken, the second shovel is just opening up a new section of the pit. But to get an idea of how things moved, the trains were loaded here, and they backed along this track to the dam where they dumped their load. The empty train would return and line up here and wait into position for the steam shovel to load it. They used a system of signal lamps to control the traffic of the train because they had 7 trains moving at all times. And later on in 1913, that increased to 10 trains. In this picture, we can see up here at the top, a machine called the Keystone Driller. And what it's doing is it's taking test bores in this borrow pit area to be sure that the filling material meets the criteria that they need to build the dam. It was very important that it be the right type of material to maintain the structural integrity of the dam. And here we see a group of individuals opening up a new section of the pit. They're laying new track for the trains so that they will be able to get in to be filled by the steam shovel. This is the Keystone Driller. The power company used it for test bores, and it also used it to drill large diameter holes if they had some serious blasting to do. The machine was originally developed by a company in Pennsylvania for drilling oil wells, and it is also used for drilling artesian wells. Here we're looking at the same borrow pit on the same day, and it will give you a little better idea of how the trains moved. Here you can see the empty trains are all lined up. This train will pull forward onto this track and then back into position to be filled by the shovel, and then will continue to back up after it's filled to the dam where it will dump its load. The dam was built by building trestles about 20 feet tall and then dumping the fill from the trestle to form dikes. And they built trestles parallel to one another so that at the beginning there was a trestle one and a trestle two about 600 feet apart or 500 feet apart. Gradually, as the dam rose, the trestles were moved in so that they got the slope of the dam. And here you can see how these dump cars work. They could dump dirt in either direction. This one's dumping on this side. That one is dumping on the other side. Here again, we can see a load of dirt being dumped. Once the dirt was dumped, these men here used high pressure water to wash down the dirt. The idea being that it packed the dirt along the bank, but the finest particles washed into a center, into the area between the dikes and settled out. Here you can see how it's a three-man job to handle these hoses. They're under very high pressure. Here you can see dike here, a dike here, with a sluicing pool in between. The trains dumped the dirt. The men used the high pressure water to wash the dirt down. The finest particles settled into the center pool, and as that dried, it would form an impervious core, almost like cement, that would keep the dam from ever leaking. And here you can also see how dike one is here, dike three, which is the next one in and going to be 20 feet taller, see how it's been moved in here so that gradually the dam will slope up. These pipes are carrying the sluicing water from this pumping station here, and they can attach the hoses onto these main pipes wherever they need them. By 1913, they needed a second borrow pit. They had moved so much earth that the west borrow pit was now quite a long distance from the dam site, so they opened up a new pit on the east side of the dam. Here we can see that it's 1913. This is the eighth trestle, which means that it's the fourth layer. There's been 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, and 8. So, and the eighth trestle leads to the east borrow pit. So they're filling, when they dumped the dirt for this trestle, they were bringing it from the east pit. And here, way off in the distance, you can see the west pit. They used these, what they called dinkies. Here's a picture of nine of them all lined up in a row for a picture. At the peak of operation, they had 10 dinkies running. They had and over 100 dump cars. And these things ran 12 hours a day, 5 and 6 days a week. And they hardly ever stopped. When they needed new coal, they would just had a, they had bags of coal beside the track, and as they went by, they would throw a bag of coal up to the engineer so he could put it into the firebox. Here we get a look at the profile of the dam and how this intake tower, which is here, and the gatehouse at the far end look. So if you went up to Somerset today and you looked at the outlet, that's the way it would look. The water comes in through here and travels through this conduit and out. These pipes are 4 feet in diameter. Here you can see the finished dam. And you can see how the trestles, you can just see the top of the trestles sticking up through the dirt. Those trestles are still there. If you dug down up there today, you'd find a trestle. They're still buried in the dam. Off in the distance, we see the West Borrow Pit, just the top of the intake tower. Now, when the reservoir is full, you can't see the top of the intake tower. It's covered in water. The spillway is way over there on the other side. This is 1914, the tracks for the railroad that they were using for fill, you can still see tracks on top of the dam. Now these tracks, instead of being used by the power company for dumping fill, are being used by the Deerfield River Railroad to cross the dam to get to the logs on the east side of the reservoir. Here we're looking at the same picture from the opposite direction. We're looking towards the east now. The other one was looking towards the west. You can see here the Deerfield River Railroad tracks running along the dam over to where the East Borrow Pit was. And you can see now that in December 1914, they've started to log off this side of the mountain. This is, by the way, this is Mount Pisgah or Mount Snow. I mean, this is where the Mount Snow ski resort is. And they were logging that particular area in December of 1914. Here's a picture of the Deerfield River Railroad number 2 engine just coming off the dam. You can see the spillway there. He's got a partial load of pulpwood on the back end of the train. Here's a loaded train coming from the east side, headed west across the dam, and then he will come off the dam and connect on to that chase branch that was part of the railroad, and eventually that load of logs will end up in Mountain Mills. And that's what the finished reservoir looked like. The construction camps were here. The east pit was over here. And the outlet for the water is right there. And you can see it's quite a beautiful area. That's Stratton Mountain off in the distance. And as I said, Mount Snow is off to our right here. Thank you very much.